Welcome to Jewish Cinémathèque, where we meet some of the important faces involved with films that tackle aspects of the Jewish experience. Today I am joined by filmmaker Dan Friedkin, the director of The Last Vermeer. The film is set in the Netherlands after the Second World War and focuses on the true story of Joseph Piller, a Dutch Jew who fought in the resistance and as an officer in the Canadian Army, returns home to Amsterdam, tasked with finding and reclaiming art stolen by the Nazis.
Everything in here was stolen, and they put me in charge of finding out who took it and who sold it to the Nazis. This was just found in Goering's hidden collection.
It's a Vermeer.
I'm Captain Joseph Piller of the Allied Provisional Government. During the war, what did you do?
Tried to survive, like everybody else.
Sold to Reichsmarschall Hermann Goering for more than 1.5 million guilders.
I need to know where this Vermeer came from.
Everyone likes Han. He's the life of the party.
What Germans attended his party?
I never said they did.
You went to one of his parties.
I went to a lot of parties, Joe. And you left.
Collaboration with the enemy is a capital offense. They're shooting people in the streets. This is your chance at redemption.
And yet I am sensing that perhaps it is you who needs redemption.
Ministry of Justice, I've heard you snagged a big fish. We'll take it from you.
Come on, this way.
This guy is an honorary Nazi, so let him swing with the rest of them.
I am an artist, not a Nazi spy.
Did he offer you some money?
How much does it cost to buy Joe Piller? Hey!
Why do you care so much about this man?
He's not the man, really. It's the fact that he's innocent.
Dan is the principal and co-founder of Imperative Entertainment, where he has produced several films, including All the Money in the World, directed by Ridley Scott, and The Mule, directed by Clint Eastwood and starring Eastwood and Bradley Cooper. Dan, welcome to Jewish Cinémathèque.
Thank you. Really, appreciate it.
It's a delight to have you. So, Dan, why this story?
Good question. You know, I've always been fascinated with World War II history, so it's always been sort of a passionate. It's an area that of interest for me. It has been. It was with my father as well. So I kind of grew up in that milieu. And you know, obviously, I'm a big fan of a lot of great World War II films. Films like Schindler's List, certainly, The Reader, one of my favorite films of all time, The Pianist, and others. And I was aware of the story. Was made aware of the story probably 6 years before we started writing the script. And in that process, I was really fascinated with the post-war experience and what happens, particularly the Jewish experience post-war, how a nation rebuilds, how an individual rebuilds. And that's, particularly through Joseph Piller's character arc, how I tried to establish and direct a film that shadowed an individual's experience and sort of mirrored that individual's experience with the whole post-war experience of an entire nation. I just was fascinated with the story, and it hadn't been told.
So you actually found this true story. You yourself, I understand, as a youth, traveled quite a bit in Europe, and so you had a feel for this. But what's fascinating about it is that you really did tell a broad story, but you focused in on Piller's sort of finding his Jewish identity again, almost as if he had forgotten it.
Yeah, I mean, I did travel quite a bit. I grew up in largely in Switzerland and France, and so in Europe a lot, and to this day spent a lot of my time in Europe, and certainly more aware of some of the French resistance stories and some of the underground activities and, you know, in other countries. But I felt like, you know, not much had really been known about that post-war experience in the Netherlands. And that's what sort of attracted me to it.
You know, a lot of the viewers may not understand the role of a producer versus a director versus a writer in a film, but you really started your film career as a producer and had produced some very successful films.
I started very late in life, later than I certainly wanted to. I've always been fascinated with film and filmmaking and, you know, cameras since I was a kid and motion picture cameras. And so I've always had this as a hobby and passion, but was never able to really use it in a meaningful way, I guess, other than my own, you know, movies of my kids and my family and home movies and such. But you know, I wanted to get into filmmaking, and I was able to later in life because I was engaged with other careers earlier on and raising a family and so forth. And so I kind of started late. I started sort of in my mid to late 40s. Producing is certainly different. I enjoy producing, but it's a very different process, and directing really is, you know, it was incredible. I mean, it was a great experience. I can't wait to do it again. I loved every minute of it.
Yeah, you know, Ridley Scott, I believe, is like a hero for you or a mentor, you know, one of the great producer directors out there. You were on the set watching Ridley direct, and was that really the moment when you said, I need total control of this story?
It was the moment that I fell in love with the process because I watched him do it. And I was obviously a producer on his set, but to be a producer on a Ridley Scott set means that you don't talk and you listen and you learn and you soak in as much as you possibly can, which I did. So Ridley, I think, respected that. We became great friends. I was in the video village with him the entire, every scene we shot, every single scene. And I just shadowed and listened and learned. And like all great things, including a big, certainly a big topic of this film, art, you know, a lot of originality is copied. It has to start with a template.
So we don't want to give away the story, but, you know, give us a sense of where you decided to take it and the very fact that you discovered this story that nobody had ever, you would have thought, what a great story, what a great film.
In terms of where I wanted to take the film or how I...
So you have this returning Canadian soldier who's actually a Dutch Jew and he's there to find stolen art, but it takes that next step, and then he has to deal with his fellow countrymen and fellow countrywomen in post-war?
Yeah, I do need to be a bit cautious here because I could easily reveal. And so I got to be a little bit careful with that. But, you know, Guy Pearce plays a great character for Han von Meegeren. That character is fascinating. I won't say too much more about him, and you know the reason for that. It needs to be sort of discovered by the viewer. But my intent was to create something that cinematically was big. I think that was part of the Ridley influence, is to show things that are, you know, from a set decoration standpoint and just the presentation looks like it should belong on a big screen. And so that was the modality that I chose for that. And, you know, it was really about tracking these individuals and what they went through. I'm fascinated sort of with the power of myth, with this notion that someone can go from being, you know, the most hated person in a particular environment to a folk hero overnight. And you know, that ultimately people believe what they want to believe and what they're led to believe. We're all that way. To a large extent. And so, you know, I think those are some of the big themes that come through in the film, as well as, of course, the way a broken country and a broken man deal with the aftermath of an incredible tragedy like World War II.
the whole question of the Netherlands.
Yes.
And the war. I grew up with this understanding and that the Dutch saved Jews and hid Jews. And yes, there may have been this one terrible situation of Anne Frank, but really the Dutch were great people. Right. And yet more and more over the last few decades, a lot has come out about Dutch complicity and collaboration. Sure. And Paul Verhoeven's film, The Black Box, really, you know, it's interesting. Early in his career, he made a film about the great Dutch resistance saving Jews.
Yes.
And later in his career, look what they did. They turned on the Jews. So what about the Netherlands, and what was it like working with the Dutch? Did you have any sense whatsoever that...
Yeah, it's interesting.
Talk about it?
Yeah. Very, you know, obviously... It was great to shoot there. One thing that I did do is we did very little on set. Some of the scenes in the loft were sort of built, you know, the rest of it. And that was for convenience and obviously for efficiency from an expense standpoint. But everything else was in situ. We shot in the streets of Amsterdam. We shot in London, in all the interior shots in London. I like the idea of having those constraints. Of having walls in a home that you are using to replicate a bedroom or a kitchen or whatever, and having to deal with those physical space constraints instead of building a perfect set. So I like that. And I certainly want to do that going forward. I like that challenge and that constraint. But working in the Netherlands was really special. I didn't get so much a feeling about the war, but I got certainly immersed in what the art aspects are and were. And I think I was able to see, I was able to feel, you know, that environment of that post-war era through art more than anything. But, you know, we really didn't have conversations that were particularly, open about the war experience, because, you know, when you're directing, you're there, you're either scouting, you're writing, or you're shooting and occasionally sleeping. Yeah.
But, you know, you made a point, and I will give away just one.
Sure. Yeah.
With your permission. There's a moment where he returns home and he pulls out a box and he opens it up and he pulls out candlesticks and lights candles. Now, why did you decide to include that? It very poignant, very powerful moment.
So his wife, he protected his wife by going into the underground and making sure that she was not persecuted or, you know, killed during the war, and certainly his son. So he saved them in effect by going into the underground. And I felt like I needed a scene or a moment where we see him rediscovering his faith a bit and passing it on in some small way, symbolically, certainly to his son, because he asked his son to place the, you know, to essentially set it up. And that scene got cut down significantly because of things that happened in film where something just doesn't go right and it just doesn't fit in. But it was a real important sort of moment. And to be honest, we actually shot that on a reshoot on an additional day. We picked that scene up later because I felt that it was important to have something there that defined that that turning point where he is now rediscovering the things that are important to him that very tragically and sadly he, along with so many others during the war, had to effectively hide to survive.
Let's take a moment now and look at a clip from Dan's film, The Last Vermeer.
Anything else we can get you?
A drink would be nice.
And who's she?
This is my assistant, Kotia Henning. Kotia, meet my jailer, Joseph.
I have to run. Try to bring you a whiskey.
Yes, if you could.
Well, she's not your assistant, is she? She's your girlfriend.
A little bit of both. She brought the paints when she took her clothes off. You know, what was I supposed to do?
Miss Henning, wait up. I'd like a word.
I'm late meeting my husband. Who knows where to find me?
All for art, I assure you.
Dan, one of the big questions, you know, we as Americans sit and we think about the liberation of Europe by the Allied troops and all of the wonderful things we did. One of the pieces that most interested me and that you brought up in this film is at a certain point, the people don't want the liberators there any longer. And we felt that tension first between the quote liberators, in this case, this Canadian officer representing that entire army that had in fact liberated the Dutch, and the fact that the Dutch want to carry on with their lives. This was really quite something. It's not often dealt with in film, and was this compelling for you as an American?
It was. I mean, you know, I think obviously the national identity, that's the only hope they had post-war, is to actually rebuild what they had in some form and retain the essence of who they are and what they are as people. There's another line that you may recall when, and I'm not giving anything away with this, but when he's in an office and he says, aren't we all Dutch? You know, why are we distinguishing between Jews and others? We're all Dutch. And that was an important point as well, to recognize that he is at the core, he has his faith, but he's also, you know, profoundly Dutch. And it was important to distinguish that, I think. And so, yeah, I mean, this is a nation, and I think so many nations, and I wasn't as aware of this issue of having to, the only way you can hold on to this hope is to rebuild your country and have a national identity and preserve that in some form or rebuild it. And that was obviously very important. And that sort of came through as we started writing more of the script, and I became more aware of that. And as that point was illuminated,
you sort of see this tension. We've seen this in the past in film, but it's really put aside the whole question of what a country after it's been liberated and after and during its recovery process. And you recreated beautifully some of the scenes, particularly when he goes to Rotterdam.
Yes,
of what it was like to be in the Netherlands after the war and after the bombings and after the destruction. But there's this, again, this is in a certain sense, it's a powerful story, it's a thriller. So it's the kind of film that you just build, and I, you know, the two of us are sitting here, we don't want to give anything away because that's the power of this wonderful film. But where, you know, this sense of, after the war, what is the role of a government trying to reestablish itself, and what does it do to those people it believes to have done the wrong thing, to have collaborated with the enemy, to have really, and to be executed for those deeds? What was that like for you to try and tackle that? And are there any contemporary issues that connected for you?
I think there's often, my goal was a little bit more of an internal one, and that was to see through Joseph's arc the few different things, but one is this notion of forgiveness of himself and of others. And as you know, early, I'm just treading lightly, I don't want to give too much away, but early in the film, we see him basically trying to fill the book of numbers and getting these people who were treasoners executed. And you get this sense that he will recover by seeing this happen to more people and justice effectively being served. What we see as the film goes on and we see his character arc develop is that he recognizes that sort of peace can only come from within. We can't keep lining people up and executing them to to feel better about the consequences of a huge tragedy like the war. I mean, that was not the solution. In many cases, it needed to happen, understandably. But ultimately, he gains his internal peace from recognizing that that has to come from within, and ultimately seeing that the number of people that are executed is not going to make him feel better about the war experience, and is not going to let him heal.
We see
what happens at the end of the film when I won't mention what happens, but he's finally able to be himself.
So art is such a central piece of this film. And I know it's very close to you personally. Music, art, what is truth and what is not truth, what is fake?
Yes.
Was this one of the key factors that attracted you to the story because of your own connection in the arts?
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that was a central thing for me, is what constitutes art. And I think it is for everyone, for all of us. You know, we all think about that. What makes art? Why is this piece more valuable than that one? When in fact, it's so subjective and all the things that are pretty obvious. And that's something that I think we all kind of wonder about. And I think that was one of the things that I wanted to do. It certainly was one of the central themes that I wanted to deal with in this film.
Our audience, knows about Dutch art. It's interesting because there's also this intersection of Dutch art and even Jewish life early on, 17th century. And here you have Vermeer, such a major player in terms of understanding Dutch art. You seem to focus in on how the people of the Netherlands are just sort of, it's like their hero because of what he represents, and he's their beacon to the outside world.
Van Meegeren?
Yeah. No, Van Meegeren, well, as an art dealer, but also the art that he has and what it represents, and whether it was stolen by the Nazis or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, what is amazing is the fact that he amassed the properties in the Netherlands that he amassed. And those are, obviously real figures. It's phenomenal. So, I mean, I don't even know if it's arguable, but maybe it's arguable, but most successful, I won't say what he is. I'll leave that to the audience, but it's certainly, yes.
Collectors
of all time. Right. And the fact that he is his story is a little bit different. His is less of a character arc, but more about a chameleon. And that was his way of dealing with the war. He was able to morph. And that was his mode of survival during the war. And one of the important things for me was showing different ways that people dealt with that experience. And I think a lot of people, from what I've seen, dealt with the war experience in very unique ways, but it was requisite. They had to deal with it in their way. It doesn't always make it right, but it makes it survivable in many cases. So Joseph Pillar's experience in the war had to be a certain brand of experience. Han von Meegeren's had to be a certain brand of experience. And I think ultimately Joseph recognizes that in the patio scene toward the end, when he recognizes that I don't like this guy. I don't like what he represents and what he is, but this is how he survives.
The art dealer and the detective of sorts.
Yes.
Let's take a look at another clip, from Dan's film, The Last Vermeer.
Han understands the human animal better than anyone.
Is that why the Germans were so fond of him?
And everyone likes Han. He's the life of the party.
What Germans attended his parties?
I never said they did. I don't know anything about Christ and the adulteress, or any Germans. And I have no idea where Theo is.
Who did Han consort most with?
Himself, me, and his wife, ex-wife.
Johanna, where's she?
Somewhere in France. She got tired of his joie de vivre. But he gave her everything, you know. The houses, the money. What other man would give his wife his entire fortune?
What did you find out?
Well, depending on who you ask, he's either Satan or a saint.
Dan, one of the things that we see in the film is the fascination and the need by Goering to have this collection of art. You know, he can easily have it stolen, but it seems that he needs to purchase this. Why didn't he just steal all of this art? I mean, they stole so much art. So.
They did, certainly. But for his private personal collection, he felt that it had to have, it's what gave it value, and it's what gave it meaning to him in his crazy way, and made it relevant in his quest to own more art than Hitler, which is, yeah.
So crazy. You know, it was such a wonderful learning experience, as well as, you know, my holding, sitting there waiting for the next thing to happen. Just tell us a little bit about your actors, because they're the European actors. You have an Australian actor, you have an actor from Luxembourg. Tell us about, you know, the three key actors.
Yeah. So Vicky Krieps from Luxembourg, I really was fascinated with her when I saw Paul Thomas Anderson's Phantom Thread. And I thought she was phenomenal. And also just the chops to be in that cast as a fairly young actress. And her ability to play that role with you know, in a very difficult situation, I was just very impressed with that. And as I got to know her, I really just had to convince her to play that role. She also has a very classic look, as you saw in the film, and you see this in the bedroom scene. I mean, it's very, I think, very, very classic looking, and certainly very period looking. So. And she's just great. She's a natural. She's really, really good. Claes is, you know, for Joseph Piller, obviously a great actor. The Square, Ruben Östlund's film, we were involved with as executive producers. He is, Claes is able to just carry the weight of everything in his face without overshowing, overtelling, and overacting. And we just liked his role very much in The Square. And
as Joseph Piller,
And then Guy Pearce, you know, is a phenomenal actor. He has a ton of range. He's able to play this chameleon-like individual. And very well. And he also, as he started reading the script and got interested in it, he really developed it. They all developed their own character. I mean, we knew the outputs that were required and needed for it in terms of the whole story, but they had a lot of latitude and were obviously very good at developing their character within that story. And so they became those individuals to a large extent, which was, you know, what you'd want out of your actors.
So here you were, a first-time director, having to make those choices of control and whatever, but you just decided to give them that kind of latitude?
I absolutely, because they're all hugely professional, and I spent a lot of time with them before they, you know, agreed to do the film or signed on to do the film. And then once we got together, we spent weeks developing the script a little bit more and trying to get everything we could out of each scene in the meaningful ways that pushed the themes and the things that, you know, I was interested in ensuring that the film had. But within that, you know, they're better when it becomes them, when it's not acting, you know, and I mean, obviously it's acting, but they really get immersed in the role and they develop it. And in many cases, that creative process pushed each scene that we shot, you know, to a better place, I thought. So, yeah, I mean, I was fortunate to work with all of them and would love to work with them again.
The Last Vermeer tackles so many issues. It deals with a Jew who was a hero from the war, a resistance person, and returning home and having to face anti-Semitism after the war at the same time as trying to make himself fit into society. And a country in upheaval trying to repair itself. Dan, you did an amazing job. Wow. First time director.
Yeah.
Look forward to the next.
I appreciate it very much. I appreciate it. It was, thank you. It means a lot. Thank you.
Wonderful to have you on.
Great to be on.
The film is The Last Vermeer. Make sure to see this film. It is just a beautiful, beautiful work. And congratulations.
Thank you. And thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Take care.
Bye-bye.